sense in the film, somebody described trying to take a photograph of him as sort of staking out the way you would wildlife photography. And there, that struck me as exactly right. And there were many people who traveled through our little village in hopes of going up to Cornish and seeing if they could catch a glimpse of the great man. And I said, you don't know New Hampshire. They will not let you close. Yeah. But I also thought, Gene, that there's this continuing, reoccurring sense. And we began it before, of this possession of innocence, which you represented as a 14-year-old girl on the beach that day, what Joyce seemed to be in her very, very open, innocent moment on the cover of the New York Times magazine, and indeed all of the other, the au pair who becomes a wife, the ingenue of Una O'Neill, all of the people, all the female important muses of his life seem to represent perhaps some kind of attempt at innocence. Can you talk about that?
Absolutely.
Perhaps a fantasy of innocence.
Well, perhaps. I mean, it's an innocence you outgrow. I look at Feeney, look at little Maddie. It's before you get pretenses, before I suppose, learn to be scared of life and learn how to deal with life. It's a guilelessness that he certainly liked it about me, and I knew that at the time. I don't even have to look back on it. I did want to say something about Graham Greene. Your movie didn't mention anything about the inverted forest, and to me, that Raymond in the reverted forest could so well have become what Salinger was afraid of becoming.
We quote you directly in the book, Gene, talking about that very point. Rest assured.
I've said this before.
You analyze it beautifully, and that's the way in which the book and film connect. The way that we talk about Salinger and innocence and women and girls is that in the book, the metaphor that we use is that he views very young girls as time travel machines back to before various wounds. So there's something immensely heartbreaking about this rather problematic pursuit.
It raises havoc in the muse's life.
This is true.
The story about the girl with no waist at all, I mean, that really even says it. The moment before she becomes a woman, when she makes that decision.
I think it's very clear that we see that kind of yearning for that earlier time, perhaps pre-wound, that you're suggesting. But I also think that there's a very complex psychosexual dimension in which perhaps through discretion you don't need to ply you or Joyce or anyone with the details. He obviously consummated his marriage and produced two children. But there is a sense of a kind of an innocent, almost platonic, almost asexual, almost frightened of sex aspect to him.
Yes.
That I'd love you to discuss.
It was very asexual. I thought of him as my uncle for many years. His fame had nothing to do with our relationship. We used to spend time together in a bed, but separately. There was Derry's power over you was absolutely mental and spiritual. I don't think really, in a way, he was all that interested in sex, but that's maybe an area that I shouldn't even.
I think it is part of this, and we've now run out of time. I've been told well beyond it, but I wanted to give Shane, who's extraordinarily long and dedicated attempt to do this obsession, the last word, maybe to comment on that, but maybe to say something else about what you have, what you've created, what it feels like. We're so honored that you would choose this moment to expose the film to the public. We think we've got the best Film Festival on Earth that you brought it here thrills us to death, and we're very, very excited and grateful.
Well, I feel the same way. It meant a great deal to me to for the film to show at Telluride, and it was a great, great honor. And I when they told me this morning, they said, I said, who's asking the questions? They said, Ken Burns. I thought they were joking. So it's a tremendous honor to have you be part of this. As I said, I've been a lifelong fan, and as Buddy mentioned, and but I did want to say that he Salinger had a fascinating relationship with women, and it's through those relationships that you catch an enormous number of the contradictions. You know, the Joyce Maynard relationship is really emblematic of this, in that he hated author photographs on the back of books. He took his photograph off the back cover of The Catcher in the Rye. But when he saw 18-year-old Joyce Maynard on the cover of the New York Times Magazine, out went that rule, and he contacted her and pursued her. And one of the things that's so striking to me is that the seduction ritual that, I don't know another way to put it, that happened with Jean in 1954 was completely replicated in 1972 with Joyce. I mean, and this really does confirm this idea 30 years apart that he was having these women replicate a pre-war innocence for him. And that's the place that he wanted to live. His favorite film was Lost Horizon, and he desperately was always trying to get back to a pre-war innocence. I mean, he was a fascinating man, and that's why it took 10 years. He was an iconoclast who desperately wanted to belong. He was a author who railed against prep schools and then sent both of his kids to prep schools. Far too many contradictions to point out here, but I feel that that through Jean and Una and Joyce, that you and Claire and Colleen is his third wife, that you do get a sense of his relationships with women and how complicated they were. And in the book, you get a much deeper sense of how intertwined religion and sex and internal conflict over those two issues are. He was constantly trying to control his impulses, because he felt that, per the Vedanta religion, women and gold were evil.
Well, so. we thank you so much. We hope you don't wait 10 years to come back to our little Brigadoon here. Mr. Hockner, we are so happy you could join us. Shane, of course, the filmmaker and co-author here. David, Buddy, Gene Miller, we thank you. Shane, you'll be happy to know that Joyce is in the front row. And if we had that time machine, we would have been able to go back and invite her up to add immeasurably to our understanding of this complicated person. Thank you all very, very much.